the Ligon P64. Now, this is a premium, high-end, single-dose home grinder and definitely worth looking at if you are looking for a premium grinder. So the Ligon P64 is a product out of the merger of two grinder companies, Optiono and Hellor. The P64 was their first grinder and have since done the latest grinder, which is the P100, which is a super premium version of this grinder with bigger burrs. Before we dive into the P64 and see what makes this grinder different, if you're liking the content so far, please like and subscribe. It really helps us grow this channel and deliver even more content. By the way, Optiono have sent us this grinder so we can look at it, as it's been a common request in comments of previous videos. But like always, I've got the ability to speak my mind and my thoughts are all mine. We've received no financial incentive. The burrs. Now this grinder comes with 64mm flat burr set and you can choose what burrs you want in the grinder. Depending on which burrs, you're going to get a very different coffee flavor profile. We're going to do this review mainly on the grinder and not so much on the burrs themselves. Now with those choices, you can look at the SSP Red Speed burrs, which are more focused towards that specialty light to medium roast in both espresso and filter coffee, or the standard burr set, which is more focused towards espresso in that traditional flavor profile. Now with the SSPs, if you're looking more towards espresso, you'll choose a high uniformity burr set. And if you're looking more at filter coffee, then you'll go for the unimodal. In saying that, the burrs are easy to change. You could always get the grinder with one burr set and change them out down the track. So it's not a big deal. And I tend to find I go through phases, espresso phase, and then for a few months, filter phase and back. So you could really own two burr sets and change them out because they're not hard to change. Dialing in the grinder. Now this grinder is super easy to dial in. I really do like when little things come together and make sense. From a dialing perspective, it's stepless and you can do infinite micro movements, so it really helps on the espresso side of things. But presuming you got the right burr set that goes from espresso to filter, you can easily move it from espresso to filter and back quite easily, especially because it's a single dose, no retention grinder, so you don't have to purge in between. But more importantly, you can easily see where you're at. The way that they've written the numbers on the hopper here means that you can see it from any angle instead of having it on the bottom plate here that sometimes you can only see it when you're front onto the grinder. It's also very neat in its approach, very simplistic, and the hopper does more than one function. So it's not only a hopper, but inside it's a funnel, so you're feeding the beans right into the center of the burr set, and the top bit here actually works as an anti-popcorning device. Obviously, you could remove this piece, but it's something I'd probably leave in there. At the end, instead of having a bellows, you can push your hand a few times through, and it really does push any remaining coffee out while grinding. It really is super neat. One thing to note, on the earlier models, they sort of had the numbers in a reverse order to what's normally conventional, where the higher number was finer. They've redone that now, so it's more conventional, the higher number being coarser, like every other grinder. And this was something in the earlier models that really bugged people, and one thing they've listened to and solved. They've actually listened to a few other things, which we'll get to, and really evolved this grinder over time. Retention. Now, retention is a hot topic, and everyone wants zero retention grinders. So the coffee you put in is the coffee you get out. It means you don't have to purge between shots. It also means you can change between coffees or grind styles very easily. With this grinder, it is a zero retention grinder, but just note that zero doesn't always mean necessarily zero. It just means super low. So if you're using an RDT method where you're spraying the beans before you're grinding, you're probably gonna get 0.1 of a gram retention. And if you're not using RDT, you're gonna get 0.2 of a gram. This is super low. As the grinder beds in, it's gonna be closer to zero. When the grinder is brand new, you do have that or a bit more. This means you're not gonna have to purge and you can change between beans easily. And depending on what your burr set is, you can go from espresso to filter and back easily. Now on the hopper side of things, you don't have a bellows, but it's also not the same setup as a niche where you just put in your coffee, close the lid and let it go. What it does is it has an opening to the hopper here. And as you get into the end of the coffee, you can give it a couple taps and that air pressure will feed any of the remaining coffee in the mechanism out. And that's when you get your pretty much zero retention. Variable RPM grinders. Now, grinders have really evolved over the last few years, from having a dosage chamber to grinding on demand to single dose grinders like this grinder. People exploring the difference between conical and flat burrs, and different geometry and materials on burrs. And now we're looking at variable RPMs. So not running the grinder at a constant RPM, having the ability to choose to bring it lower or higher. The lower the RPM, you tend to get less fines and you really do change the flavor profile of the coffee. Now this grinder is a variable RPM grinder and I do like giving the ability to have that extra control. On the flip side, it's one extra variable to deal with and I think a lot of people will end up playing with it at first, getting a little bit confused, finding a setting they like and basically set and forgetting it. But I'd still rather have this option than not having it at all. In many ways, it reminds me on coffee machines where we went to geared pumps to have pressure profiling. So different pressures at the group head. People explored, but if you look at now, the most common machines are back to the traditional rotary pumps. And I feel like it might happen the same way in grinders. But for now, variable RPMs are offering a lot more control and probably here to stay. One thing I noticed though is on this grinder, you got variable control. Timor released the Sculptor 078, which we've been playing with and we did a video on. And on that grinder, not only did they have variable control, but they had a patented and fines cleaner. What that did effectively caught those fines and you could dispose of them separately. So you didn't necessarily have to bring that variable RPM down low to get less fines. You could just collect them. And I think adding that to the mix did make things a little bit neater, but I do like where grinders are going with variable RPM, even though I think it's gonna add a bit more complexity than most people need. On the P64, you got a 300 watt DC brushless motor, and the RPM's controlled from 200 to 1400 RPM on the dial here on the side, which is super easy to turn. The only thing I find complicated is the way they've labeled the dial from 1 to 9, one being 200 RPMs and 9 being 1400. Would have been nice if they labeled the actual RPMs. I presume they've done this from a stylistic approach, but from a usability, seeing the RPMs would have been nicer. Or having some kind of correlation. So instead of 1 starting at 2, for example, and 2 being 200 RPMs all the way to 14. But the case is on this grinder, 1 to 9, and you do get a table of what those correlate to. So you can dial in and just check that table to know where you're at. So what is it like using this grinder and how does the coffee come out from an espresso perspective? The grinder, super quiet, the workflow is super easy, and the coffee distribution is quite neat from the grinder, although you can always distribute further to really make sure that bed is evenly distributed. The coffee really is delicious, nice, tasty, complex and balanced. Really is a nice coffee, in part to do with the grinder, in part to do with the extraction, but it really is a nice grinder overall. Something that's quite enjoyable to use. The pros. Now, it's a super quiet grinder, and for a single dose grinder, I really like the workflow. Super easy to pull apart, clean the burrs, and put back together without losing any alignment. And when it comes to the extras, both the portafilter funnel and dosing cup now have magnets included in them, so they fit really neatly on top of a 58mm portafilter. The early models didn't have that, and it was a gripe, but they've now fixed that, and it's solved. When it comes to the design and build quality, it feels really thought out of. It's really beautifully designed, everything's really flush, really well put together, and all the componentry that matters is metal, and it's really CNC'd to perfection. So from a build and from an aesthetic perspective, it really is neat. Now for the cons. Like everything, there's gonna be pros and cons to every grinder. In this grinder, there it doesn't really have many cons. One thing I noticed is that these days at a grinder this premium at this price point, 64mm burrs feels quite small. Especially now that Timor have released a Sculptor 078, being 78mm flat, I think this grinder with 78mm burrs would be quite cool. In saying that, option I do have the P100 with the larger burrs, but that's also a big jump up in price, especially compared to the Timor Sculptor, which is very affordable. But back to this grinder, a lot of the cons have been resolved from the earlier generations. Early on, the numbering of the hopper was kind of weird because it sort of worked in reverse to convention. That's now been sorted. Another thing was on the dosing funnel and the dosing cup, they now fit 58mm portafilters and have magnets, so that's solved. One thing that hasn't been resolved and it's only a visual thing and probably there is a reason for it, but it really confuses me, is a numbering of the RPM dial from 1 to 9, instead of being from 200 RPM to 1400 RPM. I think having the RPMs there would be a little bit more clear, a little bit more easy to remember where you're at, but it's not really 100% a con, just a design. One thing that to me is a con is the portafilter support. I don't really like the way it holds portafilters because it doesn't hold every single portafilter perfectly. There's been videos where portafilters, like the decent portafilters, just don't sit in there well. It would be nice to have a support that works better, to say like the support of the Eureka Libra, but visually it wouldn't work on this grinder, so I get the design choice of this portafilter support, but it reminds me of the same support of the DF64, which I also didn't like. But I guess that's minor in the scheme of things. It really is a well put together grinder. The competitors. Now I feel like there's three main competitors to this grinder. The Timor Sculptor, the DF64, and the Niche Zero. The biggest, or the head-to-head competitor, to me, will be the Timor Sculptor, which we mentioned a few times through this video. And the reason being is both the Timor and this Ligon have a lot of similarities. Both are super well designed and built. Both have beautiful workflows. Both you can pull out, clean the burrs, and put it back together without losing any alignment. And both have variable RPM speed motor controls. Now in the case of the Sculptor, it's also got a patented design fines cleaner, which allows you to catch those fines and dispose of them separately. And I feel like that's a really cool feature. Also, depending if you're comparing the 64mm or the 78mm Sculptor, if you're comparing the 78mm, then it's got larger burrs than this. And I feel like the larger burrs are quite nice. In saying that, the Sculptor's half the price, or even a third of the price, if you're looking at 064. And that makes it a very big gap to this grinder. This grinder really is sitting at a high price point. From a budget perspective, you got the DF64. Now, you'd want to option the DF64 with SSP burrs to be more comparable to this grinder to level down that variance, but the build quality of the Ligon is very much nicer and superior. You'd also have to option up the DF64 with aftermarket parts to really bring down some of those variances. I don't think it's going to be a head-to-head comparison, but it'll be interesting to compare budget grinder to a premium grinder and see those results. And lastly, there's the Niche Zero, super famous, cult following, but to me, they're not 100% comparable. The Niche is conical, the Ligon's flat burrs. Big difference there. The workflows are somewhat similar, but the build quality of the Ligon is far superior to the Niche. So they're gonna be the three main competitors, but none at the same price point as this. This price point really is on a league of its own in terms of being premium. So who is this grinder for? I see this being a grinder for someone that's not looking at a price point, but more looking for a premium end single dose grinder that can do both espresso and filter, maybe both, with quite a lot of controls, both in the choice of burrs, but also in the RPM and the workflow. It really is a premium grinder for more that high end setup and not so much a grinder that you're comparing on price point. Let me know in the comments below which grinder you would pick. So either the P64, the DF64, the 078, which is a Sculptor, or the Niche. And like always, if this video has brought you value, hit that thumbs up. And if you haven't yet, please subscribe. Thank you and see you on the next video.